And now I'm going to welcome to the stage in succession Heather West, who works on public policy at CloudFlare, and Christian Dawson, who is the president of ServInt and the co-founder of the Internet Infrastructure Coalition, the I2 Coalition. Thank you, Heather and Christian.
I can't believe I have to follow that. Great panel. Much less interesting, much less entertaining. So when Amy asked me to talk today, she wanted me to talk about the technology. And we actually had a placeholder title, Can Technology Make the Internet Secure? And I was planning to change it once I figured out what I wanted to talk about, and then it turns out I want to talk about that. So today you've heard, you know, how the internet works and where encryption happens. You've heard about the crypto history that has, for better or worse, shaped the technology. And you've heard about where and how people are thinking about the law. I want to talk about why we are so passionate about encryption and why we use it in our data centers, we use it for our customers, and we worked to develop better encryption to make the internet better. So why? We think that strong encryption protects the entire stack in a way that really nothing else can. Inside of this massive, diverse set of infrastructure with, you know, thousands, millions of stakeholders, encryption reduces the complexity of the system. You know, we are able to have more endpoints and more nodes, more connections with more trust because we have encryption. There are just fewer actors to worry about. We're able to do authentication of your identity if you want. You know, we can make sure that there's no man in the middle attack on your data. We can make sure that a pickpocket doesn't steal the information off of my phone. Actually, my phone is sitting there on the table and I trust it. We use encryption inside of our data centers to ensure platform integrity. There's a lot of places on the internet that this is used. I think that was demonstrated earlier today. What we want to do is show how this technology is enabling a better internet. And really, I think that messing with encryption has the outcomes no one wants. Encryption enables trusted platforms for things like Netflix, Spotify. It's the basis for e-commerce online. If I were to go to eBay and say, I want to buy this widget, all right, now I'll call eBay and give them my credit card number because I just don't trust my credit card number on the internet. You know, that's the world that happens if we don't know where the holes in encryption are. We want to raise that bar. We want to make encryption better. I want to tell you a quick story about how technology has made the internet better here. In 2012, you may remember, Iranian hackers actually went after the U.S. financial system. A couple of those banks called us. We flew out to New York and said, all right, how can we help? And they said, we want to use your service to protect against these DDoS attacks. We think that you can help, and we're a little bit at a loss. You know, they were trying to figure out how to fix this. But we couldn't, because our service to create a secure interaction required that they share their private key with us. They can't do that under the law. That would allow us to spoof their transactions, to read the transactions, and under U.S. law, they would have to report losing that key to the Federal Reserve. So that wasn't an option. Our folks went back to try to figure out, is that something we can fix? We couldn't help then, but in 2014, we rolled out a technology called keyless SSL so that we could provide encryption, strong encryption, for our customers without ever holding their private key. And suddenly, there's this new market that can use our services. They don't have to have the in-house expertise. We've made the internet more secure. We've used technology to make the internet safer. The financial industry isn't the only one using strong encryption to protect the data in transit and to protect the data at rest. I think we should all pay attention to where encryption regulations around the world are falling. You know, I think that we see the health data, financial data, e-commerce data, reporting data, military data, government data. Everyone is coming to the conclusion that encryption makes that safer, makes the internet better. Regulators and industry at this point agree on that side of the debate, that encryption is a best practice and something that everyone should be doing. I think that you would be hard-pressed to find a company that doesn't use encryption somewhere. Companies like mine are innovating to make the internet more secure. We're going to keep working and making the technology better. And we hope that governments worldwide will continue to work with us on that rather than poking holes in the technology. So yes, I think technology can make the internet more secure.
everybody. I'm very pleased to be our last flash speaker today. My name is Christian Dawson, and I'm wearing two hats today. I am the president of a web hosting company called ServInt, and I, in that capacity, I've also been elected the chairman of the Internet Infrastructure Coalition, which works to build a collective voice for the people that build the internet's infrastructure. And today I want to talk about the internet's infrastructure, basically give you a little bit of a lesson about how the internet works, and in that capacity, what the people that build the internet are doing to try and take the role of encryption and making the internet safer and more secure in some of the ways that Heather was talking about are important into the next generation. So basically, the issue at hand is that most people don't really understand how the internet works. And when we use words like cloud and like World Wide Web, we're not helping anybody. The truth of the matter is that the internet is built by people who mostly rack and stack servers and various pieces of hardware in physical locations like data centers. We talked a little bit about it earlier in the day when we were learning about where encryption lives. So these places are operated by companies within the internet's infrastructure. We're talking about web hosting providers like mine. We're talking about CDNs like CloudFlare, the company that Heather was talking about. We're talking about registries, registrars, cloud infrastructure providers, data centers. These companies make up the internet. And unlike what most people understand about how the internet works, this is a field that is mostly driven by small to medium business. That is true because when the internet was created, the US government took a sort of a wait and see approach. And they said, okay, we're going to see how this goes. We're not going to put a heavy regulatory burden on it. And it created an environment in which somebody could build an internet company in their basement or in their garage. And lots of internet companies came up, and there ended up being lots of competition. And competition is fuel for innovation. So that's what brought us to the internet the way it is today. An innovative environment where companies that make up the internet's infrastructure number around in the US by our records, it's around 35,000 companies. In the world, we're talking about more than like 60,000 companies that make up the internet's infrastructure that you use every day. And this is the underpinning of the entire digital economy, which these days is pretty much the entire economy. And everything sits atop the infrastructure of these companies. So, and here's something else. I believe that what we do for a living is a noble profession. Usually, when the only time that anybody does point to our companies, they're saying, you guys aren't doing enough about piracy, about child endangerment, about cybersecurity issues. Well, we have been on the front lines fighting these battles, these complex issues, for decades. We know them well. We've been working tirelessly with all sorts of different groups in order to address these issues. And so one of the goals of my organization is to stand up and say, we're in a noble profession, we're doing good things. So anyway, in that respect, I have to admit that the cloud and companies like ours took a big hit a couple of years ago when revelations came out about what the NSA was doing with their surveillance programs. It takes hits on a regular basis when there are major security issues. These are problems, and they're problems that we look to address. Some companies in my space try to address these issues by focusing on their privacy policies or on transparency reports. But a lot of individuals are focusing their attention on shifting to the encryption economy. And a lot of companies in our space are trying to figure out how they can regain the trust of the cloud user by innovating in encryption. And that same petri dish that created the internet, that same center of innovation of lots of really active, really competitive companies driving innovation exists today in that same space in the encryption economy. Some of the really cool things that we are working on right now, just to close up, in the encryption economy, part of the internet infrastructure, surround encryption in the DNS. The DNS is the domain name system, basically what matches names and numbers. When you put in a request in a URL, it goes up to the DNS and comes down. Encrypting that process is one of the things that we're working on. Another thing is email. Obviously, you can get encrypted email right now, but most people don't use it because it's not easy. And we are focused on trying to drive technologies that are going to make it easy, going to make it so that everybody can use it. Driving adoption is the next generation, and we are the perfect ecosystem to do that. Thanks.
All right, everybody. Good afternoon, everyone. If we can get seated and get this session for the afternoon started. It is, can encryption save us? And just to give you a little bit of how this will go down, earlier this afternoon and earlier this morning, we had posed two questions to the audience to think about. One of them being, in your professional experience interacting with encryption, what are the biggest challenges posed by the tools and technologies? And then a follow-up question of what are the biggest opportunities? If you have not had an opportunity to fill out your note card that was at your table to answer one of those questions, we've got Drew here who'll be collecting those cards as we go into our process. But I'd like to go ahead and introduce our panelists. Here on the end, starting there, we've got Matt Blaze, professor at the University of Pennsylvania. We have Holmes Wilson, co-founder and co-director of Fight for the Future. Jochai Ben-Avie, Internet Policy Manager at Mozilla. Siobhan Gorman, Director of Brunswick Group, and David Bitkower, Deputy Assistant Attorney General in Criminal Division at the Department of Justice. So what we're going to do here is a process where we're going to start listing out the different answers of these questions, and then we're going to distill it down and arrange these challenges and opportunities in the ways to address them by desirability and feasibility. Ultimately, we want to come down to a distillation of outcomes. We may not come to a consensus from all of us across this panel, but we do want the ability to distill it and see if there are actions for the stakeholders who are involved. So our first question, in your professional experience interacting with encryption, what are the biggest challenges posed by the tools and the technologies? Right ahead.
Okay. I'll give two, usability. And let me throw in one more, making it work correctly. So other than that, it's easy.
Okay.
Well, I was asked to speak from a reporter's perspective, which I can do. Until recently, I was at the Wall Street Journal for several years covering intelligence and national security issues. And I second that, and in fact, it makes me feel better because I thought I was just a dumb reporter who, you know, couldn't quite figure it out. But it required, in order to actually use encryption at the Wall Street Journal, it required them sending down the one computer security guy who we had who could do it and, like, have him commandeer my desk for an entire day and put all of this stuff on there. And I was all set to go with encrypted email and encrypted chat and all of that. And I think on, like, my fourth encrypted email, and I swear I, like, entered the password twice and this and that and the other thing, it goes out, it's not encrypted, and I was like, oh, my God, I can't use this ever again. And I ended up using some encrypted chat, but it definitely sort of will scare you away from doing it if you realize how kind of fluky and clunky it can be. So usability, I would definitely second. From a reporter's perspective, though, I'd add a second different one, which is also just the notion of encryption when you suggest it, for example, to sources who aren't necessarily that well-versed in it, will definitely freak them out and kind of ward them off. I mean, they're saying, what is it that you expect me to say to you that is so, you know, secret that it needs to be encrypted? So there's kind of the off-putting nature there, too, from that angle.
Okay.
I think from my point of view as an activist that it is trying to spread privacy tools, the biggest thing is that it's complicated. And it's not just from a usability standpoint, but the software we use every day is already mind-numbingly complex. It's so complicated. And when you add something like encryption into the mix, developers will look at that sometimes and just say, I don't even know how to get there, unless it's some mission-critical thing that they absolutely have to figure out. If you ask them to add strong encryption for privacy protection to their product, they'll look at it and say sometimes that it's just too hard and that the value isn't there. And then when developers add strong encryption in ways that just pass that complexity onto the user, the users look at it and say, this is too complicated, and they give up. And then if you're an activist trying to get developers to do the right thing or trying to get users to protect themselves, and you're trying to get people to take steps, you hit a wall because the steps you're trying to get people to take are just too complicated. So I think that complexity is our biggest challenge.
So at Mozilla, we believe that the privacy and security of users online is fundamental and cannot be treated as optional. And so thinking about security, thinking about encryption is something that happens a lot and every day at Mozilla, but we're seeing an explosion of connected devices and users. People who don't necessarily think about encryption every day and don't necessarily, they may realize the utility of encryption, but implementation of crypto and good implementation of crypto is really hard for a lot of reasons. And so I think that there's that sort of ubiquity problem, which is only sort of growing, and the number of connected devices and the number of encrypted connected devices. And then obviously sort of plus one to everyone else is saying, but I think that we also need to think about the reliance on other people's code and code that doesn't necessarily have the infrastructure needed to support it. So we're all familiar or hopefully familiar with things like Heartbleed and Shellshock. Open source tools and technologies are critical to providing security and are backbones of a lot of sort of the building blocks of the web in a lot of ways. But there's not always necessarily the sort of infrastructure there to continuously audit and patch and maintain these secure libraries that we all rely on.
So from the Department of Justice perspective, I'm not going to come at this from an IT background at all. That's not my professional experience. And I think the reason I'm up here is because one of the components I supervise in the criminal division is the computer crime section of the department. So we come at encryption from really at least two different vantage points on a law enforcement side. The first one, which is one I think we've all heard a lot about in recent weeks and months, and perhaps earlier today as well, is the challenges that can be posed by encryption when criminal actors or terrorist actors use encryption as a way of facilitating crime or preventing the detection of crime. And particular implementations of encryption that are entirely user-controlled and there's no mediating entity to give the government access pursuant to a court order. That's one challenge that we obviously face, and we've all talked about that a fair amount, I think. The flip side of that is in our public safety promotion role, and particularly in the role that we have in promoting cybersecurity, there's a real challenge out there, and I don't think we need to elaborate on this too much, but obviously in getting folks to adopt better methods of data security to protect privacy, to protect sensitive information, both in the private sector and in the public sector. And we do view that as an essential part of our role in giving advice to people based on our legal expertise and based on the facts that we've seen in cases in large-scale data breaches and even small-scale breaches of very sensitive data. It's a real challenge to get people to adopt more robust use of strong encryption and other related data security tools.
All right, Drew. Any note cards that we received from the audience or any other comments that came over Twitter regarding these questions or this particular question?
Yeah, so we have a couple of challenges so far, and feel free to bring some more up. We've got the opacity concerning the laws related to the use of crypto. We also have increased risk for those already at risk, and I think that's particularly focused on those in other parts of the world in which there's more risk for using encryption. The unfriendliness of the tools for non-technical people. The inability to secure the end device. And so that's thinking about the lack of tight controls on the production and sale of commercial malware, the dark trade and zero-day exploits, and a lack of non-governmental funding for countermeasures. Finally, the most frequently used encryption tech, SSL TLS for HTTPS, is weak. And that's because it relies on a large number of certificate authorities. And that's all we have for challenges at the moment.
Okay. Anyone in the audience have a hot burning challenge that they want to identify really quickly. All right, if not, then we're gonna move on to the next part. So what we've done is we've put together this list of challenges, and what we need to do is arrange these challenges about in solving them by their desirability and their feasibility and why. And this is the opportunity for us to take these panelists and their expertise and their unique perspectives to look at this list. And just to let you all know, there's the list that he's putting together, and there's also above you a Word document that has been tracking all of these different challenges. So based on your perspectives, just go ahead and jump in there about what order should we be putting these in on this panel today of the desirability and the feasibility to address these particular challenges.
I think usability comes first. I mean, it came up in a few of our points, and it came up in one of the points from the audience. And I think without that, you just don't end up changing the culture around the use of these tools. You know, if it stays a niche thing that only people who can handle a huge amount of complexity in their daily life are going to use, then it's not really socially significant.
So you just mentioned another point, changing culture. Do you believe there's not a culture of the use of encrypted tools and technologies?
I think products kind of create their own culture around them. You know, that seems to be the trend, whether it's social, you know, social networks or the mobile space or all the apps we think of and use kind of create their own culture and their own reason to, they create their own reasons. And it's kind of on the app to do that. But if all encrypted apps are just really hard, apps that use strong encryption are just really hard to use, that's kind of a ball and chain on their ability to create a bubbling ecosystem around themselves.
So, I mean, in all fairness, I mean, I think the usability and the correctness of software, particularly around security, is generally speaking crap. But we've had a few successes, right? I mean, you can't do an online e-commerce transaction without encryption. Now, it can fail because of things like the certificate hierarchies being weak, but you know, the fact is you don't have to do anything to make that work. You can't make an over-the-air cell phone traffic is pretty close to 100% encrypted under most circumstances, and you don't have to do a thing to make that happen. When it's integrated invisibly, it can be made usable under some circumstances, and then that brings us to our making it work right problem.
And I think that's what we need to prioritize, right, is the how do we... You know, if you ask your average user, do you use encryption, right? A lot of people are going to say no. And then if you say, do you use online banking, almost everyone's going to say yes, you know, assuming they're connected. And it's that level of seamlessness and sort of taking security to a level that while respecting user agency and giving them the insight and the ability to look at that certificate if they really want to make decisions about what certificates they're going to trust and so forth, you know, we always want to maintain that user agency, that user sovereignty, but looking at how are sort of these ways that we can sort of help to automate greater security. And I think at the same time, building and investing in open source security libraries and secure tools and technologies, those that can be audited and that anyone can use and already are baked into the code of my company and the code of probably every other company that's in this room. Investing there and these kind of building blocks of the web, I think, is also something that should be prioritized.
If I can just raise it up a couple thousand feet, I mean, because it sounds like a lot of the comments that we're hearing from the side of the room are not really just encryption comments. That is, usability, building a culture, are not, you know, there's no culture of encryption, or if there is, I haven't been invited to its parties, but there has got to be a culture of cybersecurity, right? Mm-hmm. And there's got to be more consciousness of flaws in data security methods. And from what we see, certainly in breaches that we investigate on a law enforcement side, there are a lot of very sophisticated actors out there, no doubt, but there are also a lot of folks who are getting breached because they didn't do basic hygiene. And encryption can be part of that, but it's not the only part of it. And so all of these comments, I think, are not really just encryption ones. They're more about data security in general.
That's related to a point I was going to make, which is that a lot of this discussion feels very much like the broader cybersecurity discussion, which is, well, who's responsible for making sure that software is secure or software is sort of usable and security is embedded? And, you know, it kind of, it reminds me very much of the conversations about, well, if something isn't patched, whose fault is that? Is that grandma for not, you know, updating the latest patch software on, you know, Adobe or something like that? Or is it the software manufacturer for not, you know, making it easier or on a updated on a regular basis? And, you know, as you know, technological tools become more widely used, they do have to become easier. And you don't, I don't know that a solution that relies on individuals to address the more complex sides of things are going to work. And it's interesting that incentives within the marketplace have, you know, kind of driven that when it comes to payments or cell phones and things like that. I just think it's a little odd that it hasn't happened for basic communications yet. It seems like there should be an incentive to do it there too.
But to pick up on another thing that David said, I think that cyber hygiene as a means, and sort of improving cyber hygiene as a means of dealing with some of the implementation challenges of crypto, right, is an important thing to focus on as well, right?
Can you elaborate on that?
Well, so there are basic sort of practices and sort of common sense in terms of how you run a network, how you run a server, how you run their tools that create points of vulnerability. And so there are many implementation challenges with doing cryptography right, and sure, we can talk about the math and we can talk about you know, how things are configured, but there are sort of basic sort of practices around that and around server management in particular, and how you handle user data that sort of fall more under the bucket of cyber hygiene than they do under the bucket of the crypto itself, that can help us to have a more secure ecosystem as a whole.
That sounds right to me. I guess I would say, depending on what the goal of a particular enterprise is or a particular user is going to be a whole set of different implementation questions, depending on who they want to communicate what and when and how much they want to pay for it and what they're guarding. And so every different user is going to have a different calculus they bring to that. That doesn't take away, I think, from the larger point that communications, in particular mass communications, ought to be secure. And strong encryption in communication devices is a good thing, as it is for online banking and in other contexts. I don't think it takes away from that larger point.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that, that most baffles me about, and I'm not going to talk about key escrow and the and backdoors, but the thing that most baffles me about the debate about this is there's this assumption from the proponents of including backdoors in systems that computer science is not there yet, but we're on the cusp of building these incredibly robust, secure systems that cannot be breached. And, you know, speaking on behalf of the entirety of computer science, let me just assure everyone that that is not true. You know, we're nowhere near that. We are farther away from building correct systems of the complexity that we have than we ever have been. We're writing code faster than we can debug code. And, you know, that problem is actually getting worse and not better. So when I hear any discussion predicated on the idea that we're, you know, 3 feet away from having these incredibly impenetrable systems, you know, that'd be great, but, you know, not in the foreseeable future. And, you know, we've got to work on that.
So I guess there's a couple of pieces to that. One is I'm not sure who you're talking about in terms of the proponents of putting backdoors and things. I can say with certainty, speaking for the entire United States government, that it's not the U.S. government asking for backdoors. Obviously, I think part of the reason this discussion has been challenging over the last few months is people use different terminology to mean different things, and perhaps your definition of backdoor is not the same as Director Comey's definition, and we can talk about that, I think, at length. But I think it's a mistake to think of this as a question of are there perfect solutions over here that solve perfect problems over here? That's never going to be the case. We don't live in a world of perfection. As you point out, I think very eloquently, there are vulnerabilities throughout communication devices and platforms, there's vulnerabilities throughout software, and we deal with the consequences of those every day when we investigate and fight crime, because those vulnerabilities are used to victimize people all around the world. But the presence of non-perfect systems has never been an excuse not to use those systems. Cars are not perfect, firearms are not perfect, police forces are not perfect, the government is not perfect, academia is not perfect, but we don't scrap the idea and say we need to wait until it's perfect to develop it. So when we approach the question of how do you balance these different concerns, how do you balance legitimate interests in free expression and privacy and data security with equally legitimate interests in public safety and national security, and we're all consumers of all of those things in one role or another in our lives, I don't think we're looking for ruling out solutions because they're not theoretically perfect or have an implementation perfect
don't
way.
You think our crappy computer security is a public safety and national security problem?
Absolutely.
Right. Yeah. I mean, it's a really bad one, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah. So, I mean, let me just get on record. I agree with the guy from the Department of Justice here.
I think we're done here, and that's the end of this panel.
Good meeting, guys.
Move on to the next question.
So going back to our prioritized list, so we're looking at those other challenges that are up there. Do you see anything else outside of these top three priorities of usability, where culture fit is needed, and a holistic cybersecurity approach? We need to automate security or integrate it more invisibly, where we are extending encryption by default in the background and possibly finding a way to incentivize implementation very similarly to e-commerce. And then improve cyber hygiene and practices around encryption, recognizing that perfectly secure systems are not achievable in the short term or maybe even in the long term, and that vulnerabilities abound and security is a balance.
I'll throw one other one out there, which is another way we see encryption being used to victimize people. And this is not really at odds with the other points that have been made, frankly, and it's not what we've been talking about in the larger discussion about going dark and the like. But we do see encryption used as a direct tool by criminals to attack and extort money from innocent computer users. So, for example, just last year, the department, in a huge international coordinated effort, it took down a criminal scheme called Crypto Locker, where the bad actors abroad, primarily in Eastern Europe, were using encryption to intrude on your device, encrypt the contents of it, and then ask you for a reasonable $700 in Bitcoin payment to decrypt it. And this was a wildly successful criminal scheme. In about 6 months, they infected over 200,000 users and made about $25 million, literally just in about 6 months. And we took them down about a year ago, but there's been a proliferation of other uses of encryption of this nature. I think the last stat we saw was there were about 24,000 ransomware attacks per day worldwide. And not all is necessarily using encryption, but many do. And I think the only point is there is that I don't have an easy solution to that problem either. But I think the larger abstraction is encryption is a tool. It's just a thing. It's not good. It's not bad. It doesn't know what we want or how we should prioritize our values. It's just math, as Jochai said, and it can be used for all sorts of purposes.
I think that's a really good point. I mean, the thing that we're talking about here is a technology. We're talking about a tool. In the offline world, there's a lot of great technologies that are used that have a physical presence, but they can also be used for good or for evil. So that's a really good point. So in wrapping up our priorities, any other prioritization that we have here?
I mean, the one that came from the audience about device security, I think, has to be up there because it's, you know, we don't necessarily have good solutions to it now, as Matt said, but you know, we need to think about that. I mean, if a huge range of actors can just subvert any kind of protection you're using just by getting your device, and it's not that expensive or difficult to do that, we've got a lot of work to do to protect people's privacy. So that it should be up there, but there's no good answers, it seems like.
I mean, seriously, it's easy to sort of say that's a high desire, low feasible thing to do, and that we should invest more in. But I think that we also see a lot of end device insecurity due to a lack of patching and due to a lack of updating and sort of thinking through how do we get, you know, we leave a lot of updates in the hands of users, and that's largely out of a concern for user agency and user sovereignty. And those are important values, but perhaps there should be if you are not an expert user, then you should have automatic, you know, click here to have automatic updates, right?
And the main issue is Android, right? The main issue is Android devices where tons of manufacturers are just rolling their own thing and they're never touching it after they sell it.
And that's the flip side.
That's the big solvable thing with device security. But even after you solve that, you're still in a world where
totally. Anybody in terms of where do we start?
Spend $100,000 and own you, and
it's not even that much.
Yeah.
Although I guess the point there, if I can again abstract that, is that those are not encryption problems, or not solely encryption problems, and they go to the larger point that I think Matt was making earlier, that encryption is not going to be a panacea, that there are going to be vulnerabilities in any system, even if strong encryption is implemented, even if strong warrant-proof encryption is implemented, that doesn't make your system necessarily safe. There's plenty of vulnerabilities that remain.
So that being said, is there an argument, wrongly or rightly, for people to say, well, since there are vulnerabilities out there anyway, why should I even be concerned about encryption? I'm just going to be compromised anyway. How do we defeat that culture?
So, I mean, one answer, and this is based on an assumption that might not be totally correct, or on a hope that might not be totally correct. But I think the hope is that device hacking is less scalable than most methods of mass surveillance that are based on just grabbing data off the wire. And you know, there are some good reasons to question that assumption. It might be possible to do device hacking undetectably at a very large scale, but intuitively it seems like someone trying to do that is going to run into more costs and risks. They only need to get discovered once, and that their action is at least theoretically visible on the user's device instead of happening in some, you know, closet at an AT&T center somewhere. So that's the hope, is that, and this was really relevant to the discussion that just happened about, you know, whether we should have law enforcement do warrants through device hacking or through having an encryption backdoor. Because with device hacking, at least there's the chance that it'll be hard and that it'll be expensive and that there'll be some barrier to them doing it to everybody all the time without anyone knowing, and that there'll be some barrier to other governments getting in and doing the same thing. That's the main reason to think, okay, even if we know that all of our phones could theoretically be hacked, we still should fight like hell for a world in which our data going over the wire is protected. Because at the very least, we have the hope that even if they can hack me, they can't hack everyone.
Well, and also, I mean, this is the whole concept of whether it's layered defense or what have you suggests that you're never relying on one thing to provide security. And the idea is that you obviously just make it harder. And so if it's harder to get into your system, then at the very least they'll go somewhere else, or they'll just kind of give up entirely.
Yeah, and you know, and again, we've had some success here, right? The 0% to a first approximation of credit card fraud involves credit card numbers that have been snatched over the air or off the wire, right? I mean, we've eliminated that problem. Unfortunately, we've forced them to do another easy thing, which is to break into the servers where those credit card numbers are stored, and that's a harder problem to solve. The crypto doesn't help as much as it does with the over-the-air part. But, you know, we have actually forced the adversary in that case to do something that's a little bit harder than the easy thing, which is grabbing them over the wire. So, you know, we can pat ourselves on the back for that. You know, unfortunately, mostly we have to kick ourselves because we're failing more than we're succeeding.
I'll just add to that, and even if we prevented hackers from getting to the servers to see your credit cards, they'll get it from the point of sale terminal at the actual retail outlet, which is what we've seen more recently. But I think these all sort of go, at least in my mind, to just making sure we're viewing these things in the right frame, and the frame ought to be one, I think, of generally speaking, balancing social goods against social evils. And when we do that, it may be the case that certain kinds of access, whether to the device or through surveillance, may be easier or harder. But the right question to ask is not, are we making law enforcement more expensive? I think most Americans, at least, would view law enforcement as a social good that should not be expensive. And they would view the expenditure of resources unnecessarily as a social evil, because those resources could be better used elsewhere if they were available. I think the question is making sure that we have the right kind of rule of law system in place to have law enforcement act when we think it's socially useful to act, and the right kind of barriers in place to prevent bad actors from acting when we don't want them to act. That's vastly oversimplified, I will be the first to acknowledge, but at least it looks at things in the right frame. That is, what are the pluses of certain encryption implementations, and what are the minuses of those implementations?
One potential issue with that, just to think about, and this is really relevant to the last session as well, is that it might be the case that the laws we have now for guaranteeing checks and balances assumed a degree of physical friction when it came to executing a warranted search that don't exist anymore in the age of the internet, and that the technology facilitates searches to such an extent that if we that we could get a world in which it becomes so much easier to do searches without encryption, say, we could get a world in which it becomes so much easier to do searches that the laws we have that require police to go to a judge just aren't enough because they're doing it so much more now. You know, we could see law enforcement requests happening, you know, 100 or 1,000 times more than they are now. Another example is, you know, technology makes enforcement easier in many other ways. Traffic cameras, drones, face recognition. There could be ways in which the law we have now does not strike the right balance between people's civil liberties and enforcement in an age where enforcement gets really, really, really easy. There could be some destabilization there. And then our choices are, do the hard work of upgrading the law, or try to plant the dynamics using technology. So we could say, well, right, you know, in the old days, the police had to go to someone's house and break in, and that was hard, or they had to follow someone around in a van. Now it would be great if encryption protected it, at least to the point where it's just as hard to do those things. And that's not necessarily to say that we have to do it that way, but if we don't, we might end up in trouble where we're doing way more surveillance than the law expected, and way more enforcement than the law expected, as it's currently written.
So the one thing I'll add to that is there have been obviously changes in equilibrium in the way law enforcement does business over the last 20 years. There's no question about that. But there's been plenty of other changes in equilibrium as well in terms of what the threats we face are, how serious those threats are, how easily threat actors can get at our equipment. And this is exactly the conversation we were having about 20 minutes ago in terms of the vulnerability of digital systems. And so it's not, I think, a super helpful way to look at the problem is to isolate one change in equilibrium and suggest that deserves an equal and opposite change on a legal framework while ignoring all of the other things that have been going on for the last 20 years and ignoring the vast scale of criminal activity that's been facilitated by exactly these same digital changes. So yes, we absolutely could look at laws changing the balance of government authority. We actually just recently did so with the passage of the USA Freedom Act, and those debates are ongoing on a lot of different frontiers. But the question then becomes, is if we're not going to do it through legal change, and there are not going to be particular legal balances that you think should be adjusted in having that debate, is changing the physical accessibility of information and giving that power to the ultimate end user, whoever he or she may be, is that a good way of isolating the social goods we want to maximize, or is that not a good way? Because we want to make sure, again, that we're using technology, and the technology is not the one that's using us.
So one of the difficulties that I had is that we had this, you know, there was Crypto War I back in the 90s, and then this period of peace in the 2000s where there was no crypto war going on, and the cryptographers who were bloodied in Crypto War I got to put themselves back together and get to do the work of actually securing our systems. And then Crypto War II started, and we've been drafted into this. So we had this 10-year period where we weren't wasting time talking about whether we should be allowed to do cryptography, and we actually were forced to do cryptography. It was, you know, I had to remember how to do it again. And you know, unfortunately, during that 10 years, we proved that even with the government off our backs and, you know, with the restrictions that existed on exports being removed, we still aren't very good at building these secure systems, right? I mean, we're, you know, I am in the most embarrassingly inept branch of the most embarrassingly inept branch of engineering. You know, computer security is, you know, we have failures more than we have successes. You know, this is a hugely, hugely hard problem. And one of the difficulties with, it's a huge security problem. And one of the difficulties with, you know, talking about how do we strike the right balance is, you know, we're sliding off of the edge of a cliff in terms of our ability to secure large, complex digital systems. And that problem is getting, you know, worse by the day, and we're seeing, you know, data breaches of the scale of the OPM breach only get reported when they're on the scale of the OPM breach. You know, literally, I have burned through 5 credit cards in as many months that have had their credit card numbers breached in some back-end system, and that's just, you know, blink of an eye. You know, we've got to figure out how to deal with that, and you know, to some extent, the government access aspect of this is a sideshow to the real crisis.
It's Siobhan, I know you have a point, and then we'll finish up the summary and get to our section.
Yeah, it was just almost more of a question, but I wonder why that's acceptable, because it does seem like there's been much more discussion, particularly in the past year or so, of why isn't computer security making the advances that it should? Why can't it keep up with technology? I mean, it seems like there's a higher level of acceptance for failure there than maybe in some other professions.
No, you know, I mean, there's one possibility is that, you know, I am in a field with a bunch of incompetence, and I'm not going to exclude that possibility. But you know, another problem is that it's actually there's some things about it that are genuinely hard, and these are problems that have been with us not just in the 20 years that we've been having a public debate about crypto, but in the 75 years since the programmable computer became something that we used to build general purpose devices. We don't know, at the root of it, we don't know how to build non-trivial things that work correctly. And that's been a problem, the fundamental problem of computing since the beginning of computing. And there are some, theoretical limits on the outside, and then there are some engineering limits of this on the inside that we are, we really don't have good answers for what appear to be quite fundamental reasons. And the only two that we've got that work are, first of all, crypto, because it lets you reduce the number of parts of the systems that you have to trust, and secondly, make things as simple as possible. And unfortunately, that's a losing battle against features. Every time we build a new, more powerful processor, we figure out ways to do more things on it, and those are the enemies of correctness and reliability.
I think we maybe have one more thing that works, which is that, and this is more of an intuition, but it seems like some of the sinking feeling that we all got when we found out about the Snowden revelations was just that, internet engineers and people who make products and all of us coming together online, expressing ourselves, had made this really awesome, interesting thing. And the state actor, our government, had just spent a lot of money to subvert every single aspect of it that people had worked to make at least minimally secure for their purposes, had just gotten in there and thrown all the rules away and said, we are going to own all of this. And that feeling, that sinking feeling, I feel like there's at least the possibility of a solution to in the world of breaches and bug fixes and patches and more breaches and more bug fixes. Because at least, at least if security is able to track stay up to date with the state of the art in crime and business, or crime and commerce, or crime and so antisocial behavior and social behavior are kind of locked in this detente where they're going back and forth and at least stimulating each other to keep upgrading, then that at least leaves me in a situation where I'm not looking at any player in the room that has this very special amount of power over me. I don't have to worry about, I have to worry generally, but I don't have to worry about one single actor having superpowers to come in and do things that I wouldn't have even imagined. That's the feeling we got with Snowden, that there was one actor that just had superpowers. And I think that seems resolvable. I mean, if we take steps specifically to limit the ability of any actor that has physical access to the network, for example, or that has a ton of money to invest in finding bugs, I mean, maybe that's the harder one to address. But if we focus on trying to keep everybody at the same level and keep and make it so the worst thing that can happen is that criminals have access to stuff, and that we're always working to fix that, that seems like a much less bleak world than a world where one government has access to everything.
So Holmes, that actually kind of leads into, because you're talking about solutions, talk our question about opportunities. So if we can switch gears here and start talking about what the biggest opportunities are and start to list out some of them. I kind of already sense we're already moving in that direction, so let's go ahead and talk about opportunities here with regards to cryptography and encryption.
I think, well, that I think is the first opportunity, is that is that we know that some actors have special physical access to the network. Countries have access to the local ISPs, and big players have access to everything at a physical level. And so if we're sending data in the clear over that network, they're getting all of it. And I think it's reasonable now to set as a goal or see as an opportunity, don't send any more data in the clear, ever. Don't send, just don't. And ideally, everything that we're sending across the network should be tracking some kind of state of the art. And if someone's not tracking the state of the art, we go after them and try to convince them to. That seems like one opportunity. I have a few more thoughts, but that's my first. The second is there's a couple things, as Matt said, that we have figured out. There's some success stories. Device encryption is pretty easy, works pretty well. Text secure for mobile to mobile messaging, where you don't have to worry about key sharing across devices. Mobile to mobile messaging, especially if you don't need to save the messages forever or search them, that's doable. We need to get more people doing that. And I think the last one is making it easier with projects like Let's Encrypt to let people make technology decisions that avoid sending data in the clear ever. And alongside that, campaigns like our work on the Reset the Net campaign, where we can organize companies and individuals to take steps that protect security. Also like Access's Let's Encrypt campaign. I think there's a role for civil society to pressure companies and groups of users to take these steps.
Other opinions around other opportunities posed by the tools and technologies?
Well, I mean, speaking from a reporter's perspective, obviously source protection is something that is a very important thing. And to the degree that it was sort of a widely used type of tool, obviously that would be immensely helpful. One of the interesting things that popped up in the Snowden documents was looking at the various exceptions to when data couldn't be collected. One of the exceptions was, all encrypted data could be collected. So, right now, encrypted data just sort of sends up a red flag to anybody, across the board, whether it's a hacker or what have you. It says, hey, someone deems this more important. And so to the degree that it's more normalized, I think you'll have not only wider use, but just sort of broadly more protection.
So that being said, are you saying normalization through a technological solution or through a cultural?
It would have to be both. I mean, you'd need a technological solution first that made it easy, and then a cultural solution that made it something that people thought was valuable and worthwhile.
The more that we the more that we encrypt all the things, to steal an access-ism, the less people stand out for using that encryption, right? The less those folks are put in danger. I think that in the corporate side, we talk a lot about trust, right? And trust is sort of a critical currency to making the internet and online commerce and people sort of just feeling comfortable using the internet work. And I think that we talk a lot about trust in regards to our relationship between users and companies. And I think that we also need to expand that idea of trust to think about trust in government and how sort of the government's interactions with the internet, with internet security. And I think that we also need to think about user trust in the ecosystem at large. People freak out when they hear like 2/3 of the internet servers were compromised. That's a sort of mind-blowing sort of statistic and sort of hard to wrap your head around. And increasing encryption, increasing security can obviously lead to compromises of that security, but by and large, more encryption and better encryption and easier encryption helps to build trust at all three of these levels. And that's a really good reason for doing it.
Yeah, so I think, there was an adage that a while back that if encryption is the answer, you're asking the wrong question. And, that's not entirely true, but it's true more often than those of us in the encryption field care to admit. A lot of what we're talking about are not are questions of system security, of which encryption is a part. So I have one tiny little bit of optimism, which is that we're starting to see commercial products, consumer products, actually competing a little bit on the basis of security. Now, to a large extent, the vendors lie about it or they make these crazy claims, but at least it's, at least it's something that that people appear to want. And, that's a rare opportunity. It's something that did not exist 20 years ago.
And so I have heard almost nothing that I would disagree with from the past four answers, which makes me a little bit worried, perhaps, that I'm not doing my job well. But, these are obviously, I think we fully support the idea of the opportunity to expand the use of encryption. There's a whole mass of data. I don't know that everything in clear text needs to be encrypted. That's really a choice that I think you'd leave to the end user, assuming you could reduce their transaction costs as much as possible. There's Facebook, so you can post what you want to say so that other people can read it. So there's lots of things like that. But there's a mass of sensitive data that's meant to be kept private in at least some circumstances, which is not being kept private because encryption is not being used or because of other data security vulnerabilities. And I think we share the goal of sort of migrating that big pot of stuff over into a world where it is better protected. And I do think there is, whether it's a sideshow or a caveat or what you want to call it, there is, once we're in that world of better protection, there may be debates about what the best way to implement that is that maximizes social good and minimizes social evil. But I think there is a broad consensus message here, at least on this panel, that we really be ought to focus, at least right now, on moving as much as we can into a safer world.
All right. Drew, do we have any answers from our audience, or from Twitter, or from other sources to address the what are the biggest opportunities?
We do. And if you have any others, feel free to tweet. We'll keep an eye on the Twitter wall. We have defeat pervasive surveillance by having all tools and services encrypt by default. We also have humanity rediscovering the concepts of privacy and freedom of speech through the same tools that weakened them.
Okay. And in the audience, does anyone have an idea that just came to them while hearing our speakers? So that being said, looking at these items, do any of you have any other opportunities that you've thought of based on your other peers?
So I'll just point out in the defeat pervasive surveillance comment because I feel like we should mix this up a little bit more perhaps. But it depends what you mean by surveillance, whether you're including criminal surveillance, and I would include that because that's obviously one of the harms that we seek to investigate and prosecute when we see it, and whether you include lawfully authorized surveillance by a government which operates under a rule of law framework with appropriate checks and balances. If you are in that category, I don't think defeating surveillance is a good idea. I think it's a social ill. On the other hand, there are many instances of surveillance which are either criminal or done for repressive reasons where encryption might be a way of defeating or at least reducing the harm from such surveillance.
So that being said, looking back at our opportunities that we have, arranging them by desirability, feasibility, and why, let's talk about feasibility of encrypting all the things. So, thoughts on that?
I mean, feasibility of getting to the point where we're not sending tons of data in the clear over the wire, or where sites that, you know, ask you to log in, which presumably means that there's something on the site that is for you only, are using encryption everywhere on the site. That seems totally doable, and the Let's Encrypt project seems like something that would be helpful in getting more sites to do it by making it easier. I think there's other ways to incentivize that by creating more aggressive warnings when sites aren't doing that. There's a set of things we could do to encourage that more, and I think companies are racing to encrypt more email-to-email backend traffic. That's obviously something that needs to happen. So that encrypting everything over the wire seems like a doable project in the next 5 to 10 years, maybe closer to 5 years. But the trickier part is end-to-end. And I think there's a couple gleaming possibilities there, like TechSecure and the integration of that as a back-end into WhatsApp. But I don't think it's necessarily applicable everywhere. There's a lot of complexity there.
So let me just point out that we've been talking about encryption and, you know, as if defeating surveillance is, number one, the goal, and secondly, that encrypting content defeats surveillance. And, you know, one of the big elephants in the security room is how much more revealing non-content patterns of communication have become. You know, the metadata that we generate and spew everywhere we go about our locations, about the kinds of communication we're engaging in, about who we're communicating with. You know, encryption to a first approximation doesn't solve that. We have things like specialized solutions like Tor under certain conditions that can provide certain protections for some of that. But that kind of rounds down to zero in the problems that it can solve relative to all of the communication that we're doing with all of our different devices. And, you know, if we encrypted every bit of content in the universe that we were communicating and storing, we'd still be left with an enormous amount of revelatory information around the edges of that. And that, again, is going up rather than down, and our ability to mine that. And, you know, the adversary here is not just, you know, government surveillance, but, you know, but commercial entities, you know, ad networks and so on are mining and monetizing that data. Criminal actors are starting to do that. And, you know, we don't really have the first notion of how to systematically protect that.
So you'd say that's an opportunity that is going unaddressed.
It's an opportunity for people like me who get paid to research for questions like that. So, but it's also an opportunity for us to focus attention on that problem.
I would quickly add the possibility that maybe content of conversation, while metadata is extremely significant, content of conversation has something to do, some connection to freedom of intellectual inquiry, where if governments are able to spy on that, that makes me feel like I'm no longer free to inquire. I'm no longer free to have strange and dangerous conversations because I'm going to self-censor because I don't think my conversation spaces are safe. And metadata doesn't seem to create the same class of questions just around pure conversation and inquiry, especially in a free, or relatively free and open social context.
But I think that Matt's point also kind of ties back to the point he was making earlier, which is an important one, which is just that obviously you're never going to have one particular solution here. And, you know, to the degree, it's part of it is trying to almost understand, well, what's the problem that you're really trying to solve? Because, you know, if the problem is you don't want people to read content, then encryption's a really good solution. If the problem is you don't want people to know what you're doing, that's a much different problem. And technology does have a way of evolving that once you sort of block off one avenue, it's just going to kind of create another one. And so you end up kind of with more of a whack-a-mole situation.
So going to the whole panel, Jochai, do you have a... So what problem are we trying to solve here?
I mean, the commercial surveillance problem seems like the problem with advertising, where the worst case scenario is someone can manipulate you psychologically, knowing more about you than you do yourself, into making a commercial decision that it wasn't in your interest to make. That's, you know, that's one way of looking at the commercial problem. The other problem is digital redlining, which where someone can learn so much about your negotiation point that they can unfairly subject you to a price that's higher than other people like you just because of what they know about you in ways that might map really, really abhorrently along racial lines or along class lines. So those are two problems with commercial surveillance that seem like they're worth solving. The problem, and then there's the problem I mentioned about just not, and I think the problem that motivated Snowden in his work of just not feeling like you could talk about certain things anymore. That seems like the most insidious because that's how we solve these problems. And if we're not free to talk about the problems in frank terms, we have no hope of solving them.
I mean, I think that, so I agree with Holmes in the sense that we want people to be able to participate freely online. We want people to be able to exercise their rights and to click and explore and to read and write and to do what they want on the internet. But I think as a more technical matter, I think we're trying to ensure the availability, confidentiality, and integrity of information. And so sometimes that's in the face of state actors, and sometimes that's in the face of other malicious, you know, actors who are trying to gain unauthorized access. And there's a wide variety of adversaries. And so thinking about who's our adversary helps us to sort of think through what are the best solutions and think through the best implementations. But I think that we need to be looking at sort of that ability to participate, that sort of protection of the information itself, and then sort of the actual layer of trust that goes above. You might be technically protected, but users also have to be able to trust that the systems they're using.
So I'll agree with that, but protecting the integrity and confidentiality of information are important goals, but I think the question really does demand, I think, a higher level response, which is that encryption is obviously it's not the answer, because there are so many different things we're trying to protect here, and some of those things are intention sometimes. And I don't think we can ignore that there is a tension sometimes between the need for lawful surveillance and the need to protect privacy. And the question really is, how do we resolve that tension in a way that's consistent with our values as a nation? And I think it's sort of obvious that a mathematical answer doesn't exist to that question. And we're not going to come up with one on this panel, and the answer is not going to be encryption. The answer is going to be, as Siobhan says, there's a whole host of different, there's not a one-size-fits-all answer to a million different questions which point in different directions. And so what we have to do at the end of the day is, I think, make sure that the technology is not making the decisions for us, that we're having discussions like these, and we're having legislative discussions, and we're having policy conversations in and out of government to answer the value questions and the goal questions, and then when he's sufficiently unbloodied and cleaned up, let Matt and other cryptographers go back to work to try to figure out how to answer, how to fulfill our values with our technology.
Yeah, so the thing that worries me, and it worries me a lot, is that we are so far behind in securing our digital society. You know, we're losing this battle more each day. And you know, any time we stop and talk about, well, you know, we're on the cusp of having this perfectly secure world in which law enforcement has gone dark. We're not there yet, but we're going to go dark any day now, and let's make sure that we go dark. You know, any time that we discuss that, we're taking enormously important energy and resources away from solving the much, much larger problem that we're basically sliding off the edge of that cliff. And you know, I hate to be voice of doom about my own field, but we're really not very good at it, and you guys need to stop making it harder.
So, in response to that, I think there's conflation going on in that last remark you made, right? You're conflating the different risks of what data security brings us with what the solutions are. And even if I took it completely face value, everything you said about where we are in terms of the field's ability to accomplish computer goals, and I think there's substantial reason to doubt that it's as dire as you portray it based on what we see people using and the way we've seen technology advance. But even if that was, if I agreed 100%, which way that points is a totally separate question. That is, the computer insecurity you're talking about could create risks to public safety, and it could create risks to data security. It could create risks to the government's ability to protect you. At the same time, the risk of excessive security in the sense of preventing or giving a bad actor complete control over whether he opts in or opts out to whatever societal balance we come up with also presents risks. And it's just not clear to me why it is you are weighing one as bigger than the other and what data you're using to get to that point. It seems to me those are value questions, and you're answering them in a mathematical sense without showing your math.
I think the math is kind of an intuition in this weird way, and I don't know if I can speak for it, but it's something like the intuition that encryption is this basic building block, a really, really basic and multi-use tool, and that if that, we're in a world where we need all the tools we have, and that if that tool gets shackled in some way, it could really limit its usefulness so much as to just be not applicable to entire sets of problems. And you know, I think when you look at the development of like blockchain technologies or something like that, where it's almost an entire internet-like thing built on top of just a few encryption principles, you know, if you shackle that with a rule about government access, it could just break the whole thing. And I think there's an intuition among people who work with this stuff closely that it's important in an emergent way that's hard to articulate. I'm not sure about that, but I think it's hard to show the math, and I think it, because it comes from this very deep intuitive understanding of what the internet is and what's happening now. I wish I could be more satisfying than that. Do you have a better answer than that?
I mean, I think the difficult problem is that we don't know how to build complex systems. And you know, that's kind of uncontroversially true in computing. We have no idea how to build at a large scale secure systems, reliable systems that are on the scale that we have. That's why we have Patch Tuesday. That's why every day is zero day, right? That's why we see things like the OPM breach. It's not because people are designing systems deliberately to try to keep the government out. It's that we don't know how to keep the, you know, most basic frameworks that we have robust enough to actually withstand the very hostile environment that, you know, the modern digital age is, has given us. The stakes have just gone up enormously over the course of my career working on this, and they're going to keep going up. So I think, you know, the math is, one of the variables in the math is, do you believe that we're going to, our infrastructure as a society is going to continue to be more and more dependent on digital technology? And if you believe that, and I think that that's probably a pretty safe bet, we're putting ourselves more and more at risk when we don't make it as strong as we can.
And so I guess the response I would have to that is, and without, again, accepting your premise that it is uncontroversial that we cannot build reliable and secure complex systems, that may be so uncontroversial as to be meaningless in the sense that we have to really watch out for special pleading for the digital world here as well. That is, we don't use the standard of perfect safety or perfect security or perfect reliability in the physical world, and we have to make sure that we're not setting a standard in the digital world which is unmeetable, such that we just basically forswear the other responsibilities we have to actually balance the risks. That is, a risk we take in the digital world may make itself felt in the physical world and vice versa. This came up, I'll say this came up in the professional, since we're drawing our professional experiences, we've talked before, the government has proposed, as I'm sure many of you know, an amendment to the rules of criminal procedure to ensure that there is a judge available, that there's a venue available for an application for a warrant for remote searches in appropriate circumstances. Our proposal has no effect on the substantive rules that govern when those are appropriate or not appropriate or constitutional or not constitutional, just to make sure a judge is available to hear it. And there's a lot of pushback that we got and we heard in the public comment period suggesting, to me, somewhat amazingly, we really ought to enact a law that the police should first have to try to search your house before they try to search your computer. And that smacks to me a little bit of what we're hearing in this debate, which is it seems to me a bit of a special pleading for the digital world. If we don't have a good balancing of liberty and privacy and security and safety in the digital world, the effects can be felt in the real world. That goes on both sides of the equation. Obviously, there are risks from insecure communications that can lead to harm, but there are also risks from the inability of the government to protect you that lead to harm. And those are the exact conflicts we have to try to navigate, and those are the conflicts that you hear the director of the FBI or the deputy attorney general or the president talking about in terms of deciding what is the appropriate balance, what is the appropriate implementation, and not assuming that just because something is impossible to do with 100% security in this world, we should never do it. Police are going to make mistakes. That's absolutely true. There's going to be occasionally physical searches of the wrong person. There's occasionally going to be car accidents that the police get into because they have cars. We don't say, as a result, the police shouldn't drive cars.
Sure. But I think the hope is that...
Let me just respond to one thing there. I was baffled when I heard Director Comey suggest that, you know, anybody is demanding 100% perfect security. You know, even if we were demanding that, nobody realistically thinks we're ever going to get that. Whatever the level of security and robustness for our digital world should be, I think there's probably enormously broad agreement that we are well below where it should be. Right, that, you know, well below. And, you know, if the answer is 99%, although I'm not quite sure what it's a percentage of, or, you know, 70% or whatever, we're well below whatever that number, whatever that level of security should be. And it's going down each day. I find that enormously worrisome.
But isn't there plenty we can do to address that level of security in the world of, as we talked about before, moving things from over here where they're not encrypted or they're not securely held into a world where they are securely held, without defining securely held in an absolute sense to mean no possibility of access by anyone other than the end user? Well, there's plenty of work that can be done in the consensus area before we get to the areas of conflict in terms of how to implement it.
Well, one problem is that, you know, when you add requirements to a system for extraordinary kinds of access that are outside of what we normally do in the function of that system, you make it much, much harder to build it reliably. You're increasing its attack surface. You're adding components to it that have to be secured. You're adding stored data that has to be secured, and so on. I would just participated with 14 of my colleagues in a report that you may have seen on called it Keys Under Doormats, where we talk about some of those issues. They're really hard.
No one's down in their heart, and you know, I have a smartphone that requires a complex password to get into it, but at the same time, thanks to a new feature, I can access the camera without entering the password. I imagine you consider that a complexity which creates some level of vulnerability to the system.
He's talking about stuff that's way more complicated than that.
I'm not doubting that, I suppose. The question is, when you talk about what the function is, is not a mathematical question, it's a value question, and we demand certain features and we reject other features based on a cost-benefit analysis. So when you say it's not sufficiently secure or it's sufficiently insecure, there's a lot of meaning packed into there, and there's a lot of meaning packed into your paper, I think, which is not actually spelled out, in which you're not actually explaining how you would go about making those value judgments. And that's, I think, the conversation we really need to be having.
Well, I think one of the things, when you're talking about the values of physical world and digital world, I think the thing that fuels my work and the people who support our organization, you know, we have a million or so people on our list, the thing that fuels their participation is the hope and belief that the digital world can, in some ways, be better than what we've worked out so far, right? And that we might actually be able to, within this set of possibilities that are opening up, we might be able to build things that are much better than what we have now. And so we shouldn't let the values that we have now become ceilings. You know, police can screw up in all these various ways in the physical world, therefore we should tolerate that in the digital world as well. I don't think a lot of people agree with that. When people use the internet, they see a place intuitively where they can speak freely all of a sudden, and where they can connect in ways that are really surprising, and where they can explore ideas that seem really dangerous, and seem really kind of controversial, but are also important to them. And that kind of exploration and unboundedness within a system where it's discussion and where we have evolving social norms that are going along with it is something that people are really passionate about protecting.
As well they should be, and they'll get no argument from me on valuing those things. I mean, I don't think that's particularly controversial.
Well, I mean, it comes up here, I think, because if you insist on the same types of, if a certain power is problematic, and we're making this transition to a space where that power has to take another form and have another mechanism, if the power has a good side and a problematic side, it's probably reasonable to expect that when you try to sort of move that power, like a warrant search, into a new domain, people are going to want to try to keep the positive side and not want to have the problematic side, right? And I think that's fair. So I think it's worth trying to look for ways that we can do that, where we can make people's communication way more private, where we can make it harder for the government to spy on people in bad ways, and continue to make it possible for the government to create safety and enforce the law. So the pushback is coming from that. It's not just because people are trying to insist on different rules for the digital world doesn't mean they're being unfair or unreasonable. We need lots of different rules in the world we have. The rules in the world we have are not necessarily great all the time, right? There's oppression. There are things that are terrible happening sometimes.
So, and Holmes, reiterating sort of what you're saying and summing up some of the things that both David and Matt are saying, ultimately it also sounds like we have difficulty building complex social systems. It's not just complex technical systems. We have problems building anything that's complex, and we probably need to solve the problem of how do we address complexity in these systems. It's just something to think about.
And by the way, I liked 99.9% of what Holmes was saying in terms of the way we have to think about these things. I mean, that's absolutely right. We have to look at the pluses, we have to look at the minuses, we have to make sure we're balancing those things. And I think the desire, I think, that you'll see in terms of moving the conversation forward is to having a more concrete discussion of those questions. That is, it shouldn't be enough to say, this is really hard. It shouldn't be enough to say, it will never be perfect, therefore we shouldn't try it. The question is, what are the downsides, and what are the upsides? What are the threats from both sides of the coin, and how do we get to a world through our complex social systems and other ways that we have come to some sort of democratic consensus about what the ultimate values are here and how we resolve those tensions.
Yeah. So I disagree a little that this is a question of values. I think if we take what, you know, there are certainly values to be discussed here, but I think if we even take the perspective of the Justice Department, the FBI, and so on, I don't think Director Comey wants the world that he's asking for. I think the world in which we build systems with this added constraint of ensuring law enforcement access is going to cause such an increase in the kinds of digital crimes that are going to become more serious that, you know, even if we take, you know, all the things we disagree about values, we're going to have the, and put them aside, we're going to have the things we agree about get a lot worse. And that really scares me as we rely on these systems more and more.
So I think we just have one last comment for pretty much everybody. We're running short on time, but go ahead, Siobhan.
Okay, well, I'll be brief, but actually just jumping off the point that you made earlier about complex social systems, I feel like sometimes it's also very easy, particularly in the U.S., to think about it as sort of like our values and you can forget that it is actually, I mean, there's no geography around the internet, and so part of that social complexity is that you're not just talking about a set of U.S. laws and certainly not a set of international laws and certainly not a set of agreed-to norms that everybody's going to be operating on, which just makes it that much harder.
Any other last comments? It kind of looks like you have one stored up.
Sure. So I think this is a really fascinating conversation. I agree a lot with Matt. I mean, I think that we can have a conversation about what are the values and what are sort of the calculus and what should be the trade-offs and, you know, to what extent should different actors be able to access different pieces of information. But I think that the idea of holding this up as sort of like, can we get absolute security? Of course not. But we can agree that inserting a vulnerability into code is definitely a step backward, is a choice that puts people and devices at risk. And we might be able to sort of say, maybe that's a risk worth taking, maybe. But I think we can all agree that there is a very significant piece of risk there. I think this gets multiplied and amplified by orders of magnitude when we think about, you know, how do you take this to its natural extreme, right? Matt started to sort of lay out this sort of dystopian future, but so everything that has encryption has to have, you know, some tappable capabilities, right? I mean, there are so many things that use encryption today. The world of unintended consequences here is huge. And then what happens? Do you block code that doesn't have that kind of backdoor capability? Do you ban open source technologies because people can modify them and recompile them? I mean, where does that stop and where are the limits? And I think that we've been having a conversation, and a national conversation, and a global conversation about the appropriate limits of government surveillance. But I think that we need to look at the full end of the road of sort of the implications and not just be talking about this in terms of a very narrowly scoped conversation of, you know, sure, there are legitimate moments of government surveillance and need for access to user data, but the implications of how that happens are much broader than I think the current debate has been at.
I'll have David answer this, and we'll have to wrap it up.
I was going to say, I don't, both Siobhan's comment and Jochai's comment sort of bring new issues into this, which could each be their own panel or symposium or what have you. So I'm not going to even attempt to answer them all because I agree that they're important issues. Just an answer to the last point, though, about introducing new vulnerabilities. This is, and the reason I brought up the sort of camera on the smartphone point is we do live in a world of vulnerabilities. We have vulnerabilities in the physical world. We have vulnerabilities in the digital world. And it's not just because we have to, it's because, at least as evidenced by the decisions we make, even the knowing decisions we made, it's because we want to have them because they have some countervailing benefit to them. And so we have cameras that you can access without the password, you have windows in your house, you've got a fire escape in your apartment building in case there's a fire. These are all vulnerabilities. They're all vulnerabilities that we've chosen to have, not because you need to have a fire escape to build a building, because we think it's a good idea. And so that's the ultimate question I think we have to ask is, whatever the solution would look like, whether it's a technological one or a policy one, however it would play on the international world, is what do we want in terms of balancing the appropriate level of privacy and security and public safety and national security? Those are the ingredients. And how do we get to a place where we're comfortable with the outcome? And how do we make the choice and not have technology make that choice for us?
So I think we have to leave the answer to that question to the next crypto summit. Unfortunately, I'd like everybody to please thank our panelists, Matt and Holmes and Kai, Siobhan and David. Thank you very much.